Today, I'm going to help you figure out which types of gut infections are most likely behind your unique IBS symptoms, so stay tuned. If you're a returning viewer, welcome back. And if you're new here, welcome for the first time. My name is Amanda Malicheski, and I'm a certified functional nutrition gut health coach and digestive and allergy detective. And I'm also the host of the online program called the Calm Digestion Method. For weekly videos on how to figure out your unique root causes of your IBS and find your personalized plan for calm digestion, please consider subscribing and be sure to hit the bell to be notified when I post a new video. If you've wondered what kinds of underlying infections may be driving your IBS symptoms, you're going to want to keep watching this video today. I meet an awful lot of IBS patients, and many of them are concerned about different types of infections that may be causing their symptoms. But sometimes I find that their assumptions are leading them astray from where they really want to be focusing their attention. So if you've ever been confused about what exactly is causing your IBS symptoms, go ahead and leave me a comment that says, "I get it," down below this video. So today I want to take a little time to help you distinguish between some of the common underlying infectious causes of IBS, so that you can be more likely to start looking in the right neighborhood and therefore get yourself to the right testing and treatment faster. So let's get started. And a quick disclaimer for this video, there can be some serious causes for digestive symptoms. So if you're at all in doubt about the seriousness of what's going on for you, please do meet with your doctor and talk with them about what's going on. There are two different types of underlying causes for IBS. There are non-infectious causes, and these would be things like food intolerances or structural problems in your gut. And then there's infectious causes. And these are when your symptoms are caused by some kind of underlying infection or post-infection syndrome. So in this video today, I want to help you distinguish between the different kinds of infectious underlying causes, because a lot of time people come to me confused about what they're seeing. You know, they'll say, "Oh, I'm sure that I have a yeast problem," but then when we talk through exactly what's going on, it looks more to me like it's a bacterial problem or something else. Now, obviously, the best way to determine which specific kinds of infections you have is to rely on testing of some kind. But gut testing is definitely expensive. Like, a GI map is $389 right now. SIBO testing is close to $300 or so. And so this can be cost prohibitive, and it can be really helpful just to get an idea of which zone you're talking about so that you can be really targeted and specific with your testing to help confirm what you already suspect. Fortunately, there are some key clues for different kinds of infections that can help us distinguish between different types of underlying infections. So let's break this down a little bit. Now, the single most common underlying cause of IBS that we've determined with research is something called SIBO, which is a small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Now, SIBO symptoms and IBS symptoms are very, very similar, but here are a couple of clues that might indicate to you that you specifically have SIBO and not something else. Number one is if your digestive symptoms started soon after a case of food poisoning. And the second clue would be if you have a history of abdominal surgeries or injuries or endometriosis. There's plenty of other preceding events, but these are the two very most common things that lead to the development of SIBO. So if you have a history of food poisoning, you have this history of injuries or surgeries or endometriosis, and you have bloating, constipation, or diarrhea, it's highly likely that you actually have SIBO. Now, there can also be other bacterial causes of IBS symptoms. These would be things like C. difficile infection or Shigella, which is like a foodborne or fecal-borne bacterial pathogen. Short of testing, there's not really a clear way to determine that, yes, you specifically have these bacteria. But typically, these types of illnesses have profuse diarrhea as a clear symptom. So if you have a recent onset situation of really severe diarrhea, it's likely you may have one of these bacterial invaders that's really dramatically affecting your gut. These kinds of infections can also come about from a recent course of antibiotics for some other unrelated infection. Like, for example, I had a client who was prescribed antibiotics prophylactically before some dental work, and that triggered a case of C. difficile infection for her. So that's another thing to look out for. Now, another really common bacterial infection that can cause IBS-like symptoms is something called H. pylori infection. Now, H. pylori is typically associated with a handful of other common symptoms, things like burning in the gut. Ulcers are a side effect of H. pylori infection. You may have something called gastritis. You may have found this on an endoscopy procedure that you did with your doctor. And also a sensation of bloating or slow digestion, or like food really sits in your stomach and feels very irritating. So if this picture goes along with your IBS symptoms, I highly suggest that you talk with your doctor about getting tested for H. pylori. Now, there are other kinds of infections besides bacteria that can be impacting your gut and causing IBS-like symptoms. And one of the more common options is yeasts or candida. Now, candida is a normal and natural inhabitant of our gut environment, but sometimes because of different factors, it can become overgrown. And this overgrowth can cause bloating and some other symptoms that are similar to IBS symptoms. Now, there are a few distinct symptoms for candida specifically, and these can help you determine if that's what you're dealing with alongside your IBS symptoms. These include things like fingernail or toenail fungus, frequent oral thrush or vaginal yeast infections, especially if they've followed a course of antibiotics for something unrelated, rashes, brain fog after eating carb-rich foods, and symptoms that are made worse by eating yeasty foods or drinks, things like bread, wine, or beer especially. And of course, sugar. So if your IBS symptoms go along with this other sublist of symptoms, you might want to talk with your doctor about trying to address fungus and seeing if that makes a difference for your symptoms. And a quick tip here is that a lot of times after people complete SIBO treatment or treatment for another kind of bacteria, they can now be left with a yeast overgrowth. And sometimes this also needs to get dealt with as a follow-up to their initial treatment. What about parasites? A lot of people with IBS symptoms are worried that they have parasites. And I certainly was worried about this when I was sick because I live in a rural place. I drink water from a spring and sometimes from other people's wells, and I swim in a wild river every summer. So yes, parasites can absolutely be an underlying cause of IBS symptoms. But interestingly, for all of the IBS patients that I've worked with over the years, a very small percentage of them actually turn up to have parasites. That's not to say that parasites are not a problem. I'm just saying commonly it's more likely to be SIBO or some other problem. If you think that you may have a parasite infestation, how do you determine whether what you have going on is that or something else? Some of the more reliable predictors of a parasitic infestation include things like symptoms that wax and wane with the full or new moon, having an elevated level of eosinophils on your complete blood count, and this is if the level is at or above 3%, anal itching, histamine intolerance, and frequent insomnia. So certainly if that looks like you have this unique combination of signs that points to a parasitic infection, this might be something you want to discuss with your doctor or naturopath. You might ask, what about viruses? Well, typically viruses come and go and they don't tend to have lingering effects for people, but for some people, they can linger and cause problems long after the initial viral infection. And one really clear example of this is COVID-19. Since lots of people have encountered the virus and been sick with the virus, I have definitely heard a series of case histories and reports from people who have had lasting digestive impacts after COVID, sometimes just for a short while, sometimes for months or longer. I even had a client who had developed celiac disease as a consequence of their COVID case. Testing for viruses can be really tricky, so your case history here is going to be the best option to help you connect the dots with your clinician. So hopefully these mini profiles of different types of infections can help give you an idea of what's involved with these different types of infections and help point you in the right direction of testing for further evaluation. If you're going to go on to SIBO testing, I highly recommend the TrioSmart test or using the Food Marble Air 2 device, and I will leave a link for that below this video that would give you a small discount. For non-SIBO bacteria, yeasts, and parasites, I prefer the GI MAP stool test. And if you just suspect parasites, I do recommend the parasites.org Precise Parasites Home Test Kit. I recently made a whole video about that, reviewing that, but I will leave a link below this video for that test kit, and that also does give you a small discount on the kit. So I hope you have a clear idea of which specific types of infections might be involved for your specific IBS symptoms, and that this helps give you a clear idea of how to approach assessing yourself for them. Certainly, assessing yourself is one of the most important steps towards finding your unique relief plan for your IBS symptoms, but it's really only one of the very first steps in the process. And beyond that, it's really important to have a rock solid strategy to direct your approach to
taking those assessments and figuring out what kind of plan you need to complete. So if you'd like to get your hands on the exact strategy that I teach my students inside my Calm Digestion Method program, please feel free to grab a free copy of my Roadmap to Gut Recovery. You can get your free copy of that by going to confluencenutrition.com/roadmap. And I will also leave a link for that below this video so you can go grab that easily. All right, let me know if this video was helpful for you by clicking like and or leaving me a comment or a question below this video. And next, you might want to check out this video called IBS and Candida, How to Navigate Treatment, and I will see you all next time.